A little bit of a So we became really good friends with Bone Thugs and Harmony, and we're riding around in their tour bus because they asked Lee and I there to be with them as their spiritual protectors. That's what they told us. So we're hanging, and all the guys like in the music industry are going, how did you guys do that? They were like dumbfounded. So at the same time that was going on, Lee comes over to my studio. This is what it looked like, the one I used to have in Hollywood. It was built in a really ancient building that Charlie Chaplin used to rehearse in with Mabel Normand back in the 20s. And this is the second floor that I redid. The floors were like awful, and we refinished it and everything. Looking out my windows, you could see the Hollywood sign. And so we were doing this project there, and then Lee said, you know, what other documentaries might you want to do? And I said, well, you know, the Bible Code really intrigues me. But I said, I don't know any of the rabbis. I don't have any money to do it. I'm already finishing Beat the Drum and this project, and I have no idea how that would ever happen. Well, he ran off for 10 days to produce music for Ricky Lee Jones, Chuck E's in Love. You probably remember that tune from a long time ago. And she's done like a dozen albums since then. And so he gets back from that, and his brother Paul was in New York. So he gets on a plane, and the flight's canceled due to bad weather. So he goes 2 days later, and his seat assignment puts him next to this guy that looks like a rabbi. The guy was Professor Robert Herelick from City University in New York, who is the guy that knew all the world experts on the Torah codes. They were his best friends. Lee lands in LaGuardia and calls me on his cell phone. He said, hey, Rick, I think you're going to want to talk to this guy. And I'm talking to Professor Herelick. I had nothing to do with this. It was all God. It was just like, I just mentioned it would be cool to do this project. Next thing I know, I'm talking to the guy writing the software to search the Torah. It was weird. So, you know, I actually thought, I knew that TBN had been interested in doing it, and I really wasn't interested in doing something with TBN all that much, unless they would help fund this so we could actually do it. And so I called Robert and I said, hey, have you guys got any new codes or any new tables that are really cool that I could pitch to try to raise the money to do this? He goes, and then he floored me. He said, Professor Rips and Rabbi Glazerson will be in Los Angeles tomorrow. Here's their cell phone number. Now, you have to understand, Professor Rips is the guy who is considered the originator of the Torah codes. It worked with Doran Whitstam and Yoav Rosenberg back in from 1976 through the 80s to develop the software to search the code. And then towards the end of the 80s, they enlisted Alexander Rotenberg, a graduate of Moscow University, to write the version that does the graphic representation we see today. That's how we got that. So Rips is like a mathematical genius and was a complete atheist, brought up an atheist, lived in, it wasn't Yugoslavia, but Czechoslovakia. He grew up there, tried to set himself on fire when the Russians invaded to protest. Horrified onlookers rushed up and put the fire out, and they sent him to a psychiatric prison for 2 years. And then another guy complained that Russia was putting people in jail for no good reason, so they threw that guy who complained into jail and released Rips. And Rips was picked up and sent to Jerusalem. Now, he had no idea what Jerusalem was like. All these guys with weird hats and dreadlocks and, you know, stuff hanging down their pants and like long jackets, like what in the heck? You know, he didn't know what it was. And that's the life of the rabbis there in various levels. And so he thought, well, I guess I better study this Torah book and see what this is all about. He'd never done it and everything. And he told me in the interview, which is in that little blue DVD that I have, that he discovered it was a book of miracles. Because it is. Think of all the things that happened in the Torah. We think of miracles as more like stuff that Yeshua did. But really, there was so much crazy stuff that happened in Exodus, the Ark of the Covenant, the ephod that would light up when you'd ask questions to it, you know. Just on and on, the story of Joseph and reading people's dreams. I mean, it just goes on. It's just rich in detail with so much stuff. So he, as a scientist and brilliant mathematician, he had to prove that the Torah was real, and the only way he could do it was mathematically. So he delved into it and realized it was encoded. And his first clue to that was in 1976, there was a rabbi by the name of Yaniv. And I'll make this brief because I know this is it's late and I should have given everybody chocolate bars. But Yaniv turned him on to a guy named Weiss Mendel, who had found this skip letter thing. And so that's when Professor Rips got together with two other guys and developed some software. And that was kind of a tall order. Then there's another thing called gematria. And gematria is not the same. Gematria is like every Hebrew character has a number, and always has, and they add up. So, I mean, in this particular case, there's stuff that all of these sentences, it says the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob added up to 776. Kingdom of David and the world forever, 776. Come back to me and I will come back to you. They all added up to 776. What it meant, we don't know. We just thought it was really interesting. But I found that gematria isn't as, I don't know, I don't want to say it's unimportant because then I would make my rabbi friends feel bad. But I think it's cool. But it's not as involved as the Torah codes are. But here's gematria.
Liberty, 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 liberty.
All that emptiness. All that silence. I'd forgotten how much I loved it.
You really?
And this needs some sound, guys.
Hey, Max, Lenny Meyer. Sorry, put it out.
This is from the movie Pi.
What do you do?
I work with computers, math.
Math? What kind of math?
Number theory, research mostly.
No way, I work with numbers myself. I mean, not traditional. I work with the Torah. Amazing. You know, Hebrew's all math. It's all numbers. You know that? Yeah, look. The ancient Jews used Hebrew as their numerical system, eh? Each letter's a number. Like the Hebrew A, Aleph, it's one. B, Bet, it's two. You understand? But look at this. The numbers are interrelated. Like, take the Hebrew word for father. Av, Aleph, Bet. One, two, equals three. All right? Hebrew word for mother, aim, aleph, mem, 140 equals 41. Sum of 3 and 41, 44. All right? Now, Hebrew word for child, all right? Mother, father, child, yelad. That's 10, 30, and 4, 44. Torah is just a long string of numbers. Some say that it's a code sent to us from God.
That's kind of interesting.
Yeah, that's just kid stuff. Check this out, okay? The word for the Garden of Eden, Kedem. Numerical translation, 144. Now, the value of tree of knowledge, all right, in the garden, right? Eitz HaChaim, 233. 144, 233. And you can
those
take those numbers.
So the, you know, like the Fibonacci sequence?
Fibonacci
is an Italian mathematician in the 13th century. If you divide 144 into 233, the result approaches theta.
Theta?
Theta. The Greek symbol for golden ratio, golden spiral.
Wow. I never saw that before. That's like that series you find in nature? Like the face of a sunflower?
Wherever the spirals.
You see this math everywhere. Mac?
He couldn't take it. Even in the Torah. So Rips did a table finding the Fibonacci sequence. And all the numbers are there in a very small table, all stacked up neatly. And so this is the idea of equidistant letter sequencing, ELS. And if you look at this block of text, we've got pretty good projectors here, so you should be able to read it. But basically, the text says, this is the form we use for finding codes, and I added letters precisely placed to form a longer example. But the word order appears at the front of each sentence. So basically, when you search the Torah, you're getting like the computer to find a word, and it makes a long string and basically makes a spiral of that whole thing, and then cuts it down the middle and unfolds it, and you're seeing it that way. That's how the computer's doing it. And this is the man who discovered it, was Rabbi Weissmandel in the 50s. And this is what he discovered. Basically, just using his finger to count, he found the word Torah in the book of Genesis every 50 characters. So then he thought, well, I'll try it in Exodus. Same thing happened in Exodus. This is counting with his fingers, no computers back then. So in the book of Leviticus, he thought, well, maybe it's in Leviticus, and he couldn't find it. So then he goes, okay, every 8 letters then. And he found Hashem, or basically the God with no name. And then in the book of Numbers, he found Torah backwards. And in the book of Deuteronomy, he couldn't find it in every 50 letters. He goes, oh, but that's the book that Moses wrote, so he doesn't get the perfect number 50. So he'll get 49. And sure enough, the word Torah was in Deuteronomy backwards. So what do you have? You've got Torah, God, mirror image Torah. That's just counting with your finger. It's what's kept me interested in this all this time. People have also said, well, how are they forcing these letters to go sideways and up and down, vertical, horizontal, and diagonal? And they're not. It's just the way it comes out, and it has to do with resonance. Here's a physical example of that. This is a cadmium plate. It's basically a piece of steel that's attached to a subwoofer, and it's vibrated by a sweep oscillator. And they're just putting salt on it. So 345 hertz, you get that pattern. It's all natural. It's in nature. It's the way things work. The Torah codes work just the same way, except they're doing it in software. The size of the ELS means it's going to be horizontal, vertical, backwards, forwards, whatever. You can see how elaborate it gets at higher frequencies. So here are the world experts that I'm going to introduce to you. Professor Eliyahu Rips, who I've been talking about, just a sweet, humble, soft-spoken genius. I've been to his apartment in Jerusalem. I've spent a lot of time with him in New York when he was here a few years ago. And he writes me when he's worried about America. He loves America, and he worries about me. Thinks it's getting too violent here. Professor Robert Herelick, he's actually a professor of, his actual title is Distinguished Professor of Computer Science at City University in New York. What he's currently doing, the last time I talked to him about a month ago, I actually had Gladysen in the car with me. He came to visit me in Los Angeles. So we were, I said, let's call up Robert and see what he's doing. So I can usually never get him on the phone because he's so busy teaching. I said, so what is it you're doing? He said, I'm working with DNA. And I said, oh, we've done quite a bit of that ourselves. What are you doing? And he said, he said, until about 10 years ago, they only thought that there were 20 amino acids in DNA. And I said, okay. He said, well, we found there's actually 22, the same number of amino acids as our characters in the Hebrew language. And he said, now we think we can have a different way to find Torah codes using DNA and actually find in-depth information about anybody. And I said, that's crazy. And of course, a lot of my Jewish friends believe in reincarnation. When they read the passage of Nicodemus, you know, what do I have to do? You must be born again. They go, oh, well, that means that he's being reincarnated. They all think that. I mean, that's just the way they believe. And I'm going, well, not necessarily, but I mean, that's what they think. So Professor Herlich believes that the DNA would even show everybody's past lives. I mean, that's how deep into it he is. This is what always intrigues me about the whole orthodoxy. And this is Rabbi Matityahu Glazerson, who's done, I don't know, 3,000 tables maybe by now. He writes me every day, sends me new tables all the time. We work together quite often. He's like part of the family. He'll come over to my house and raid my refrigerator. You know? And, you know, and I really mean it when I say, and I've told other people this, but I really mean it because, you know, I'd be like in the stairway where he can't see me and I'm tearing up. I told, Lord, you know, it's almost like I've got Elijah walking through my house. This is just so cool, you know? And, you know, we have this really weird relationship. He knows I'm a Christian and he's a, you know, Orthodox Jew, you know, glot kosher. Everything has to be just so. I've actually cooked for him at home, you know, and he'll ask me, what do Christians think about this? And I'll say, what do you think about that? And we have these really deep discussions about stuff I couldn't have with anybody else. I mean, because he knows all about the Torah, plus he knows all about the ancient Jewish mystical texts, which I don't look at as being scripture, but I do believe that God, these are God's chosen people, right? We all believe that. So God has imparted certain information on that maybe the rest of us don't quite get. So I want to know what he knows. I'm really intrigued with it. And it's not like I'm going Orthodox or anything like that. I just want to have a better understanding of these guys so I can better relate to them. And if I'm sharing Christ with them, I don't do it in a way that it offends them. That we can stay, you know. But at this point, we're like, he's like part of the family. This is Professor Alexander Rotenberg. He's a graduate of Moscow University. He's just incredibly brilliant. He was the guy that invented the Torah code crossword puzzle of look that we're talking about. He was the guy that did the graphic representation of the codes that we use today. This is Art Levitt. Art Levitt is just really super straight-laced about the codes. If you haven't done them a priori and if you don't know the p-value for them, then they don't mean anything. They're like ordinary, he said. So he works really close with Rips, and Rips and him get along really great. So I really respect Art's stuff. And but they all have their own way of looking at the Torah and pulling things out of it. Glazerson has this really deep understanding of ancient Hebrew. Art Levitt looks at it kind of mathematically like Professor Rips does. Rotenberg's totally different because he's at like the coding level himself. I mean, all these guys are incredibly brilliant, talented, and I love hanging out with them. So here we go. It's one of my favorite tables. It's beyond coincidence to me. So you have this whole line of text. It says, what is their heart, United States, the abomination unto the Lord, and 90-degree angle at the same angle as this, Obama and Hillary. And then right here, the left. And then right here, crossing it, they are defiled. But the weird thing is, all this came up under the plain text, an abomination unto the Lord, Deuteronomy 17:1. And they didn't, you know, Glazerson didn't force this table to end up on the plain text that actually said that. It just happened that way. So, you know, and then at the very bottom it says, cursed will be the taker of bribery. And that's also in the plain text. The next is one by Art Levitt. His are real simple, clean, and direct, and couldn't have been put there by random chance. Saddam will die, hanged, like his brother. All in a tiny little table with just maybe, 150 characters? So it's not like stuff scattered all over the page like you see on YouTube, that kind of deal. It's just a tiny little, very precise table. Here's another one. You guys know who George Norrie is at Coast to Coast AM? Well, George had me on to talk about the Torah codes when we first released the film, and this guy calls in from, someplace in Canada at 10 till 2 a.m. in the morning to ask, is the Torah codes the book of life? I said, that's a really good question, and Glazus and I have discussed that. And wouldn't it be ironic if we've all been carrying the book of life around with us, going do-do-do-do-do, and, you know, are our names in there or not? And so the reason I began wondering if that could be the case is because I asked Glazerson, can you find everybody's name in the Torah? No, we can't. I said, you can't? So that made me really suspicious, like not everybody's name was in the Torah codes. So then when I said that on the air, George goes, I got to know if I'm in it. I said, okay, well, we got to take this offline because you're going to have to give me some personal information. He said, okay, I'll call you tomorrow. So George calls me at home and gave me all this info, and I gave it to the rabbis. And I said, look, there's 3 million people listening to this show. We got to do a table for George Norrie. And I don't ask this lightly because I know it's a lot of work. So it took them 3 weeks, and they did 9 tables for me. But this particular one was done by Professor Rips, and it's typically his style. It's a complete sentence. I'm not trying to ignore you guys over there. I can only point at one screen at a time. But basically, they understand that George likes the paranormal, okay? So the whole string right down the middle, the key words for this table say, loves the paranormal, but clear cut. So he's not like crazy. He believes the paranormal's real, and he loves dealing with it. That's George, okay? And then Art worked on it too and found broadcaster right there, radio, crossing the whole deal, and then Norrie right next to it. And it was incredible. I printed these out on really big pages and sent them to George so he'd have them. Here's one that Matitya Glazerson keeps looking up my name and pin light in the tables. He keeps finding stuff. I don't ask him always to do this, but then when we released the film in 5775, he found the keywords, the code will be distributed. And then right under it is my name. And he goes, well, that's really significant because your whole name came up. And then off to the right, it says, son of Jesse. And then over here, doctrine of Messiah, Glazer son, Matityahu, his name is in there. And then the cool thing is at the bottom where it says, your eyes which see the deeds of God. Then this is one he just did for me. And this is the keywords were Torah code, the code of Messiah, Pinlight, my company name, Ephod, which always comes up in Torah code tables sometimes. And it says 5736. 5736 was the year that Rabbi Yaniv gave the information to Professor Rips that caused him to start looking into the Torah codes. 5736 is 1976. And 5775 is when we first released the film. The deeds of God will show to the world. Then this is one that we have actually in the film. It's the Twin Tower Table Massacre, Twins, Towers, Ishmael Massacre, September 11th, the terror attack. Over the plain text that says, and fell from the people this day about 3,000 men. I mean, there's the whole deal right there. And that's in the plain text, non-encoded. Then this is one on Brett Kavanaugh, which is really, really, when I first thought of that, well, okay, it's a little messy, but then I started really getting into it, which sometimes these take some thought to truly understand them. So you see in a row, it says feminine plot, and then right above that, hatred, and Brett's name there, and the other side, the keyword was Kavanaugh, and against, and then the date, 2018, left, and Amalek. Amalek is always the evil thing. And then the word Samael. Now that was, in Jewish parlance, Samael is an evil angel, the opposite of good. But what's really interesting is the desolation of God, or the left hand, which is so, when I read that, I'm going, wow. I mean, that's like hidden information that, you know, it's the left that was after Kavanaugh. Here's one that we found, because I asked them about it. On the 1st of March, Breitbart was poisoned, will be killed, in the plain text, will be killed in 5772, which is 2012. I mean, that's a really clean table. I mean, there it is. Here's one that I thought was, because we were looking up 2012 tables, we thought maybe that something would happen in 2012. But Glazerson nailed it with this table. Change in the world. On the 10th of Tevet, which is the Jewish calendar for December 22nd. If you remember the Mayan calendar and all of that, the change in the world was supposed to happen on December 21st, right? So this is the day after that in the Hebrew calendar year of 5773 because the dates overlap. We haven't had a new year yet. They had their new year already. So for them, it's 5773. For us, it was 2012 still. And this comes out, change in the world the day after the Mayan calendar was supposed to explode or whatever it was supposed to do. And if you think back, a lot of things have happened since then. I mean, the whole world has gone like, you know, everything has been crazy since that time. So this is probably one of the most famous tables. It's the Twin Towers one that Professor Rips found. And there's a little piece of video here that I did a long time ago, but it's so cool that you have to see it again.
Just empty. But when we came to chapter 20 of this book, then all of them suddenly appeared in one place. This shows very clearly how everything concentrated in one single place.
So what he's saying there, he had tractor feed paper. He printed out the entire book of Numbers from the Torah, all of it, and just rolled it out there. And all of the codes for the Twin Towers attack ended up in this little tiny space in chapter 20 of Book of Numbers. There they all are right there. The chances of that are 1 in 10 million. Here's the same table and comparing it with a random monkey text. A monkey text is just a randomized text that has the same number of characters. That random text took 4,488 letters to achieve the same results, whereas Rips's table has 234 letters. Here's another table they did. Herolic did this for me as a comparison. Another random text, 7,772 letters it took to achieve those words, and they're all scattered all over the page. So, you know, if you say it's in Moby Dick or if it's in War and Peace, it doesn't work that way. Now, this is getting into Planet X. I mean, a lot of people, either you love the idea or you hate it or you think maybe something's to it or not, but the Jewish rabbis are totally into it, which surprised me. Because I was listening to a lecture yesterday about Tower of Babel here, and it reminded me of one of my early conversations with Glazerson. And I'm rushing because I don't have much time, but if I go over 5 minutes, there's no one after me, if you aren't falling asleep by then. But we got a late start. But when Glazerson was over at my studio, somehow we got to talking about Noah and the flood and the Tower of Babel. And I'm dying to ask him what he thought of UFOs and all that, and if they were in the codes, but I didn't know him well enough in those days. And then he goes, oh, yes, the Tower of Babel was a launching platform for space vehicles. And I said, what? And this is a guy that looks like Elijah sitting in my office telling me this. So we know about Nimrod, we know about all that. You know, in the book of Jasher, it says that he wore, and I talked about that, I mentioned this to Gary Sturman the other day, he said he wrote a 7,000-page article about this idea of Nimrod wearing Adam's clothes that God made, and it empowered him. Did you guys know that? I thought that was really intriguing when I read that for the first time. So Glazerson totally believed that the Tower of Babel was something more than just to go up to heaven. It was really going to heaven. Spaceships were landing and stuff like that. It was like a normal deal. So Planet X is a great table. In the end of days, and then in the plain text, in yellow, it says, I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star will come out of Jacob. A scepter will rise out of Israel. An interesting thing is, in the Zohar, which is a Jewish mystical text, it says, after 40 days, when the pillar rises from earth to heaven in the eyes of the whole world and the Messiah has appeared, a star will rise up on the east, blazing in all colors, and seven other stars will surround that star, and they will wage war on it. So there was a guy, basically all this text below is talking about, there was a man who claimed he was the Messiah years ago. And the Jews didn't believe him because they didn't have the planet in the sky that's predicted in the Zohar. So without that, they knew the guy was a fake.